To the book of 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 through 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 6 through 8. When you have it, say amen. If you don't have Bibles, we'll have it available for you on the screen. The Bible reads and it declares, "For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing." Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your living word. Your word is true and it will not return void. Prosper your word where you desire to send it. Father, speak directly into me, through me, for me. Guide my tongue to only tell the truth and to declare the oracles of God. As I yield, Lord God, I now decrease, asking that you would increase. Have your way. We throw out the red carpet saying, King of kings, Lord of lords, God of all creation, have your way. Move in the aisles, move in the hearts, move in the minds, move in the lives of your people this morning. We thank you for the victory. We bind every evil spirit, every hindering spirit, every lying spirit, and every spirit of distraction. Satan, get out. The Lord rebuke you in the name of Jesus, the Lord King. And Father God, we thank you for the victory is done by the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. We say amen and amen. Before you sit down, look your neighbor in the eye with an attitude and say, it's a fight to finish. Look somebody else in the eye and say, it's a fight to finish. Now shout, fight! Give God a praise as you have your seats in the presence of our Lord King. Amen. How many know it is a fight to finish? Thank you, Holy Spirit. We thank you for who you are and for what you've done. Amen. Here, as we get into the word this morning, amen, we find the Apostle Paul writing to his spiritual son in the Lord, Timothy. The scriptures teach us, amen, that Paul left Timothy so that Timothy can run the ministry, so that Timothy can run the church. Timothy was a young man. He was a young lad, and the Bible teaches that he was a mixed breed. Timothy was half Gentile, and he was also half Jew. So Timothy dealt with many different afflictions because he was in the middle of it all. He, being a son of a Gentile and also a son of a Jew, had to deal with the discord that was between the two sides. Not only that, but he had to deal with the many issues that were going on in the church during his time as a shepherd and as a pastor. Amen. So I have to imagine Timothy being young. Timothy found himself in a very discouraging place. Because of the challenges he was facing in ministry or in life or things that he was dealing with, he was very discouraged. And I have to believe that at one point, he was at a point where he felt like, I just don't feel like it. Is there anybody in the church this morning that have ever felt in your heart, I just don't feel like it anymore? I guarantee you that if you be honest with God, God will do something amazing with you today, exceedingly and abundantly above all you can ask or think, according to the power in you. There are times where you just don't feel like it. Somebody say hallelujah. One of the things I've learned, family of God, is as generations have gone by, we find, amen, that in this generation today, we have a generation that is very intelligent, very smart, very gifted. Today's generation is amazing. Today's technology, you can't even, I'm telling you, it is something else. It'll blow your mind what people are able to do today. This generation is more advanced than any other generation before it. This generation has things that we didn't have or that people didn't have way back then. But this generation we live in is a lot weaker than the previous generations before. Smarter, but weaker. More talent, but weaker. Let's talk. Let me say it more like this. Have more, but don't have enough tolerance. Have more, but very impatient. We live in a generation today where they want everything to be microwave and they want everything to be instant. They want to throw some water on it, and they want to watch it grow immediately. They want to plant a seed today and get mad if it don't show up tomorrow. Oh, y'all not talking up in here. Somebody say hallelujah. We live in a generation today where the generation do not know how to endure the process to get to progress and the blessing and favor, or I'm going to say, as Paul was talking to Timothy, to get to the place where you can actually receive the reward that you have been waiting for. We all want a quick reward. I want to be able to start a thing and I want to see it come to pass today. I want to be able to pray about a thing right now and open my eyes in the AM and it's at my doorstep. Well, way back then they had to go through a journey to get to where they needed to go. They had to deal with something to get to where they were trying to go. And the Bible lets us know, Paul speaking to a younger generation, Timothy, who I have to believe who was very weak in his heart at the moment, he had to reassure Timothy that though you're going through a process, this process is setting you up for something bigger than what you've been dealing with, something greater than the things that's going on in your life. Touch somebody and say, there's some big stuff getting ready to happen for you. Many people desire to succeed. We all want to succeed no matter what. We all want to receive the reward. We all want to get to the place where we can say we finished something, amen. But we have to understand that in order for us to succeed, true success in the spirit as well as in the natural, meaning building a family or building a career or building a ministry or building yourself up on your most holy faith, true success takes time. True success means you got to go down and you got to go up. True success means you got to bury some stuff and then you got to build some stuff. True success means you got to uproot, then you got to replant. True success means you got to go through a process in order to get there. And through the process, you and I got to be determined in our hearts that we will fight the good fight of faith until we see the reward. Do I got anybody in this church? Shout to your neighbor and say, fight. This generation has to get up. It's time for us. When I say generation, I'm not talking about our children. I'm talking about the age we live in. The age we live in. The age we live in. Because it's not just children. It's all of us. It's us as a people. The body today is a little different than it was back then. The body back then didn't mind being in a lion's den. The body back then didn't have no issue with a furnace. The body back then didn't worry about a struggle because they knew the body back then would take their only begotten son and take him on top of a mountain and get ready to sacrifice him and wait for God to say, don't touch him because I got a lamb in the bush. That's what I'm talking about back then. But today, give me your son. No. Dedicate your car to me. Oh, no. Take your best stuff and give it to the poor and then follow me. That's a hard one, Lord. this age today are at the point to where it is very hard for us to see the reward because we have, like we should, the endurance to get to the fruit. We got enough patience, again, to plant seed, but we don't have enough patience to water it. We don't have enough patience to wait on it and then water it again and then wait on it and then water it again and then wait on it and then water it again and then wait on it and then keep on waiting on it until we see something happen. Come on, somebody. That's the time we're living in today. But the devil is a liar. God is getting ready to activate his people and stir his people and get his people back in position, because there is some stuff that's in front of you that you got to grab hold to, a destiny that must be fulfilled and a purpose that got to come to pass. But in order for it to happen, you got to be able to endure and stand no matter what you're going through. Somebody shout, "We will fight until the end." Say that again. Say, "I will fight until the end." If we're going to see the reward, if we're going to finish the course, if we're going to see greater things happen for us, both in this time we live in and eternal life later, we have to make sure we do these four things. Number one, we have to make sure that we're staying faithful to God. Faithful. Somebody shout, faithful. Faithful means that we are to be committed to God. But we cannot be committed if we don't first do what the first part of that name means, which is faith. See, there's no commitment if I don't believe. I'm not committing to someone or something that I do not believe in or believe for. You will only commit if you believe. A lot of people throw in the towel because they lost their faith. And the reason why people are losing their faith is because they lowered their expectations. Because in order for faith to work, my Bible says that what? Faith is the substance, which means it's the ingredients that you need to receive what you hope for. Key word is hope for. Four. So faith don't work if you don't hope. Ask your neighbor next to you, what are you hoping for? Hoping as in not maybe. Hoping as in I am confident that there's something in front of me that's getting ready to hit me in my life, and I'm not going to take down. I'm not going to give up. I'm not throwing in the towel. I ain't trading nothing in. I'm going to stand because I'm expecting something in front of me. It's the evidence of things not seen. So in order for my faith to work, I got to have hope. My Bible also says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. They that come to him must believe that he is. Another version said that he is God. Slap somebody high five and say, he's God. Your problem is not your God. Your problem is not God. Your stuff you're dealing with is not your God. Your house is not your God. Your car is not your God. Your God is above and beyond and greater and greater than anything you're going through. My Bible says, greater is he that lives in me than he that's in this world. Stop speaking of the excellence of the enemy. Oh, I'm prophesying already. Stop speaking of the excellence of the enemy. We always magnifying what the enemy has done. The devil's busy here. The devil's trying me there. The devil trying to take it. The devil trying to make it. Stop talking about the enemy. So the only thing that needs to come out of your mouth concerning the enemy is, Satan, the Lord rebuke you. End of story. Now I'm going to speak of God. God is good. God is on the move. God is great. God is opening doors. Miracles is coming. Signs and wonders are following me everywhere I go. Greater is he. My Bible says, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Come, let us exalt his name together. Where are the people of God that will activate their faith and bring glory back to the Creator?
If I'm going to finish anything, get to the goal to see the reward, mother, I got to have faith. I got to believe. I got to put my confidence and my trust in God. Another word for faith means that it is the medium, the middle place by which the power of God is made manifested into my life. In order for me to see the glory, I got to believe. Jesus said the reason why he couldn't perform many miracles was because of their unbelief. Slap somebody high five and say, lack of faith is holding you back. Sometimes it's the devil trying to hold me back. No, sometimes your unbelief is holding you back. So number one, I got to have faith. Say faith. If I'm going to finish the course, I got to have what? If I'm going to get my purpose fulfilled, I got to have what? I got to have faith. Number two, not only do you have to have faith, but you got to have, I'm going to say, you got to have focus. You got to have focus. You got to have focus. Your faith won't work if you don't focus. Once again, there has to be something I'm expecting. But the key thing is, I got to focus on my expectation. I got to look beyond this issue and focus on God. Let me take you there. In the book of Hebrews 12, go there, media. Hebrews 12, the writer tells us, we do this by what? We do this by keeping our eyes focused. Keep your eyes, your focus on who? Jesus. No, look at the problem you're going through. No. Jesus. Look at how they're treating you. I'm focused on Jesus. But I'm trying to make moves and I'm trying to finish something and I'm trying to receive the reward. I'm trying to see the blessing, the favor, the fruit of my labor. But I've got so many things in front of me, Pastor, you just don't know what I'm going through. Stop looking at that and start looking unto Jesus. The Bible said, keeping your eyes on Jesus. The original version says he's the author, which is the writer, finisher, which is the completer of my faith. But I'm going to take you deeper because according to the New Living Translation, he says, keeping your eyes on Jesus, the champion. Slap somebody high five and say, we are in a fight and we're serving the champion. Oh, I'm feeling something in my belly. If I'm going to get into a battle, if I'm going to get into the ring, and I'm going to throw blows, and I'm going to try to go to the top so I can receive my reward on my belt, I don't need a trainer that never won nothing. See, the reason why a lot of people are losing in the battle, because you got people in your corner who ain't never won no battle. So if I'm going to get somebody that's going to train me so I can know how to war, my Bible say he trains my hands to war. So if I'm going to get somebody that's going to help me, I need a champion. So the champion. I saw that movie Creed. I grew up on Rocky. I should love that. I still love it. But what's great about the movie is he wanted to become great. Young Creed wanted to become great. He wanted to be a champion. So he didn't go to just any old body. He went to a legend. He went to a legend, somebody who was in the ring, somebody who won the battle, somebody who defeated enemies. He went to The Rock and he said, look, Rock, I need you to train me. Rock gave him a hard time, but after a while, Rock said, I got you, I'll train you. And with the proper training, he went in and won the battle. What am I saying? We have a different Rock. We got a Rock named Jesus. And if you go to The Rock, that can never be broken. If you go to The Rock, that will never be moved. If you go to Jesus, the author, the finisher, the champion. What would he do? What would the champ do? Touch your neighbor and say, what is the champ gonna do? When you go to the champ, let him train you. The champ is gonna do something, and this is what he's gonna do. Elder Riley, the champ is going to initiate and perfect. Hallelujah. So he's going to start it, initiate it, activate it, stir it, and then he's going to perfect it, which means bring it to its proper place of maturity. Perfect what? Your faith. Why do I need my faith activated and perfected? Because in order for me to get to the finish line, I have to be operating in perfect faith. Perfected faith. Perfected faith means there's no wavering with me. It don't mean I got this whole lot. No, all I need is a mustard seed. Now, with that mustard seed, I got to be steadfast, unmovable, and always abound in the work of the Lord. So that perfect faith that I'm talking about is a faith that cannot be moved. Why? Because I'm founded on the rock. So he perfects my faith. Why? Now watch this. How did Jesus operate in perfect faith? And how is he, being champion, going to train us to operate in perfect faith? Here it is. It says, because of the joy awaiting him. The reason why he operated in perfect faith was because he had expectation. He had something in front of him that he was waiting for. And because he was expecting, his mind, his heart, his soul, his spirit, his life was tied to the expectation, not the situation. Ooh. Oh. Oh. We can go home right now. God bless you. See you next week. Let me say that again. He was tied to the expectation, not tied to his situation. A lot of us are tied to situations and we've lost grip to the expectation. But God is saying, reposition yourself and retie yourself to the proper place. I'm going to hook into what I'm expecting, not hook into what I'm going through. So because of the joy of what was in front of him, that's good. Because when I tie my spirit to what I'm believing God for and expecting God to do and expecting God to take me into, that alone will make me happy. There's a joy that comes over you when you have hope and expectation and confidence and know that there's some better things that's concerning you. When you start knowing, but you going through. How are you able to laugh and smile and you only got $2? How are you able to laugh and smile and you sitting there in a half a bedroom house? How are you able to laugh and smile through this? Because I know something that y'all don't know. And if you would grab hold to what I know, then you'll smile with me. Because I got something in front of me I'm waiting for. My final destination is, I just know that I know, because of the blood of Jesus, I'm going to heaven. But until he come and get me, I know he ain't gonna leave me in this pit to leave me down and bound. He gonna pull me out. If he put me in it, he'll bring me through it. Slap somebody high five and say, neighbor, get ready for the great things to come. So he had joy. Can you be in the lion's den and praise? Can you be in the furnace and shout? Can you only have some top ramen and dance? It don't matter if I gotta go to the grocery store or I gotta go to the church to get something. Wherever I get a blessing, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continuously be in my mouth. You know why? Because I'm awaiting something. My champion, the champion trainer of my life, have showed me something, that if I focus on what's to come, I will keep my joy. People have been losing. That's why people are giving up, throwing in towels, because they ain't got no joy. No joy, no fire, no passion. Fire. Touch your neighbor and say, what you need next is fire. Oh, I'm going there. I need some fire. I need some fire. Oh, God. If I stir up my faith, and I keep my focus, I'll have me some fire. My Bible say his word is in me like fire shut up in my bones. My Bible says he will baptize me with the Holy Ghost and not with fire. The fire of the Holy Ghost, he'll restore my drive, restore my passion, restore my energy, restore my enthusiasm. Do I got a witness in the church? Do I got a praiser in the church? Somebody shout, Holy Ghost, set me on fire, set my marriage on fire, set my house on fire, set my kids on fire, set the church on fire, the consuming fire, the sweet perfume, your awesome presence, fill this room. This is a holy place. Set us on fire.
Fire. If I'm have faith and I'm focused, then I'll be on fire. If I'm on fire, it takes me to my next one, because a person on fire remains faithful. If you're on fire, then you'll be faithful. You'll be committed. Commitment, commitment. Loyal, dedicated, devoted to. We can't be devoted to something that we're not on fire for. If you ain't got no fire concerning the ministry, or no fire concerning your marriage, or no fire concerning your career, or no fire concerning where you're going, if there's no fire in you, you won't be faithful to it. That's why we need God to set the house on fire. Oh my God, I feel that in here. Lift them hands and say, Lord, I need you to restore my fire. Bring the fire back. Bring the fire back. Bring the fire back. Bring the glory back. Bring the power back. Bring the anointing back. There can be no fire. There can be no fire without the fuel. Fire. I only can have fire when I got fuel. Touch my ass. Ask me, is there any fuel in your tank? Is there any fuel in your furnace? See, my Bible said there was 10 virgins. 5 of them had some oil. Other 5 didn't have enough oil. And there's some people in here who's running out of oil. That's why you ain't got no fire. But if you can get some new oil, tell somebody, say, I need some fresh oil. Now, my God, I feel the Holy Ghost. Go ahead, Holy Spirit. Because there can be no oil if there's no crushing. So the oil can only come through a broken vessel. There got to be a broken vessel in order to release oil. The olives got to be broken to release the ointment. It's got to be a crushing, a shaking, a filtering in order to release. Now watch this. And there also has to be a waiting, because you can squeeze oil out, but if you don't let the oil stay for a season, the longer it stays, the better it is. So there's no fire without oil. The oil is the anointing. So the reason why people don't have no finish in them is because their anointing has been running dry. The anointing in them has been running dry. And the reason why the anointing in them, the oil in them, the glory in them is running dry is not because it's non-existent. It's because people have gotten out of position. Can you shout and say, Lord, put me where the oil runs. Put me in a place where there's some oil. I can't be everywhere, because every place ain't got no oil. Every friend of mine ain't got no oil. Every workplace ain't got no oil. Every community don't got no oil. I need to be where the oil is so the oil can keep running. I need to be in a place where I could get broken before you so you can flow freely through me. So, fire. Somebody shout fire. And wherever the fire is, passion and commitment exists. So if I'm on fire, then I'll be faithful. When I'm on fire for God, I'm faithful to God. When I'm on fire for my marriage, I'm faithful to my wife. And let me say that, 22 years, same woman, don't need nobody else. And ain't never had nobody else. Be
because I'm on fire. Ain't nothing dry about my marriage. I still look at her like my girlfriend. What's up, girl? You know what I'm saying? Boo boo, woo woo. You know what I'm saying? Who too? What's going? I mean, I'm just saying, that's my girl. My rib. Put some sauce on it. Fire! Thank you, Holy Ghost. So people lose fire because they ain't got no oil. They got no anointing. They got no anointing because they out of position. What position, Pastor? You should be on your face praying. That's your position. What's my position, Pastor? The word. Because faith only comes, develops, and grows by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Where's my fire? Who do I focus on? Jesus, the author, the instrument, the initiator, the activator, the vessel that stirs up my faith, the champion that leads me to my victory. Somebody shout, Lord, set me on fire again. So where the fire is, there's commitment, faithfulness, devotion, loyalty, loyalty. And when you're committed to something, you're not going to be moved by anything. When you're faithful in ministry, faithful to your family, faithful to wherever it is, you might be in school. You might be in college. But if you lose fire concerning what you're trying to accomplish, what you're going to find yourself doing, ooh, this is good, is changing your major over and over, ooh, again. Do I got a friend? Touch somebody next to you and say, neighbor, God is telling you to be committed. Too much changing. Once again, why? Because we have a people today who, if it ain't going my way, what I'm going to do is I'm going to trade it in. I'm going to salvage it. I'm going to let the repo come and get it. Ooh, it's quiet. I'm going to exchange it. If I can't change it, I'm going to exchange it. That's the mind of people today. If I can't change it, I'm going to exchange it. I'm trying to change her. Change him. Change it. Change that. When I can't change it, I'm going to just exchange it. How do you not know God don't want you to stand still? See, that's good. Touch somebody and say, God don't want you to change it. He's using it to change you. Wow, that was good. I said, he ain't using you to change it. He said, I'm using it to change you. I got to change how you do things. Change how you think. Change how you act. Change how you react. Get you together. Somebody say, Lord, change me. So people who got fire is faithful, and people who are faithful, catch this, people who are faithful finish. People who are faithful finish. But I found this out because I can't get ahead of myself. You cannot finish without a fight. So you have to fight hard to finish. You know what I found out? It's not... The first lap of a race is easy because you kind of just jogging and stride, you know, you just. But if it's a 10 lap type of thing, you kind of jogging, you're like, I got this. This is how we are in ministry. We launch off like, I got this. This is how we are when we first get married. I'm your Romeo girl. This is how we are when we first get the job. You know, we just be jogging and whoo. I got this. I can win this one. Yes, Lord. So we go lap number one. I got this. Lap number two. I can make it. Lap number three. I can take it. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I can do it. It's that last lap. It's when you at the point to where you about to see something big and something is getting ready to shift and something's getting ready to turn, and the door's getting ready to swing open, and the family's getting ready to shape up, and the job is getting ready to come, and the raise ready to happen, and you're getting ready to graduate. It's that last lap when the ministry is taking off, when the new building is going up. It's the last lap. It's that lap where you running and now you done did 9 and you said, oh God, this that last lap where you start feeling tired, start cramping up, start feeling weary while doing good. But my Bible says, be not weary while doing good. You shall reap if you don't lose heart. Do I got anybody that will push for that last lap? Touch your neighbor right now and say, we got one more lap to go. This is your moment. This is your season. Push your way. Fight. Move. Go. Press. 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 You're almost there. Is it that last lap? Well, we get tired. It's when we start saying, I'm tired of this. It's that last lap where we start huffing and puffing. But the huffing and puffing is not only a tiredness or a weariness, it's a huffing and puffing. I'm upset. I'm tired of how he treating me. I'm tired of how she treating me. I'm tired of them not blessing me. I'm tired of working hard. Ain't gave me a raise in 10 years. I'm tired of being in school and not finishing. I'm tired. Anybody been tired? Sick and tired of being sick and tired? So you know what you got to have? A Jacob's mentality. Jacob was on his journey. God gave Jacob a word. It's time for you to leave your father-in-law, head back to your main roots, your foundation, the place where your reward is. Ooh, it's time for you to leave where you are to get to the finish line. All right. Jacob gets up. He starts his journey. But in his head, he remembers something that was said by his brother. If I find you, I'm going to kill you. Because you stole my birthright. You deceived me out of my blessing. The name Jacob means the deceiver. So Jacob, in his head, is on his way back to a promise, on his way to a finish line, trying to finish a course in his life. And on the way back, he's thinking, I have to imagine, this dude gonna kill me. So the Bible says he sent his family ahead. He stayed behind by a tree. And he sat there for a minute because he was in the moment I would call the valley of decision.
All right, come on.
A tired place, a hard place, but a place I gotta make a choice. It was in that place where the champion showed up.
All right.
The initiator and the champion and the perfecter of his faith showed up right where he was. The Bible says the Lord came where he was. The angel of the Lord, meaning the Lord showed up. And it says the Lord, and they wrestled all night until the next day. It was a never ending, an all night battle. Ooh. Touch somebody and say, neighbor, the author and the finisher of your faith has showed up into this room and he's picking a fight with you. You say, what? Jesus just moving through. Kind of just moving through to say, hey, Jacob, how you do? But Jacob was like, I recognize who you are. I know the glory of God just walked up on me. And I'm not going to just let you pass me by. Let me talk to somebody in this church that have recognized that the Spirit of God has showed up into this church. And you made up in your mind, you're not going to let the glory cloud leave without grabbing hold to your purpose, grabbing hold to your blessing, grabbing hold to your miracle. Jacob said, I'm not letting you go until you bless me. So Jacob and the Lord presence, the presence of God, they fought all night long, wrestled. And the thing is, ooh, my God, Ooh, that's good. The Lord says to him, let me go. You know, that's a test. How bad do you want God to do this thing? That's a test. Because he said, let me go. Man, we didn't been at this all night. And Jacob says, I'm not letting you go until you give me something. I'm not letting you go until you bless me. And the Bible says that the Lord, the angel of the Lord, hit him on the side and knocked his hip out of joint. Tell somebody high five and say, I don't care what I got to do to fight. I don't care if I'm down to my last limb. Let me say it this way. My last dollar. My last nerve. I'm going to fight till I see it. I'm going to fight till it happens. I'm going to fight till the miracle come. It don't matter what I got to do. I'm going to keep on pressing my way. I'm going to fight the good fight of faith. So the Bible says, Jacob wrestled with the presence of God. Now you say, Pastor, what are you talking about? Wrestling with the presence of God. You wrestle with the presence by praying. I'm not leaving this place, God, until this thing change at home. I'm not leaving this place, God, until you open the door for me to get the job. I'm not leaving this position, God, until you bring all of my family back together. I'm not leaving this position, God. I'ma stay on my knees. I'ma stay on my face. I'ma grab hold to you, God. I'ma wrestle in the spirit. And I'ma grab hold to your presence. I need your presence. I can't let you go, God, until you heal my body. I can't let you go, God, until you send me the check. I can't let you go, God, till you save my brother, till you save my sister. I'm not letting you go till you change my name, change my attitude, change my thinking, change my perception, change my perspective. Change me, God. Change me, God. Change me, God. I'm not leaving this place till the breakthrough comes. Change me, God. So he fought. And in closing, God changed. And then he said, you know what? Because you like to wrestle, I'm changing your name. From a lying deceiver to a fighter, I'm changing your name. Your name is your character. Your name is your identity. I'm giving you a new identity, a brand new DNA, and I'm going to cause you to fight. Therefore, every time you open your mouth and fight with a praise, something's going to happen. Every time you open your mouth and declare the decree, something is going to happen. Every time you open your mouth and sound the trumpet like an alarm, it's time for battle, something will happen. Do I got a praiser that will open your mouth, lift your voice like a trumpet, sound the alarm on his most holy mountain? So your name shall be called Israel, which means to struggle with and for God. He said, for you have struggled with God and you have prevailed, which means you prayed until you got the reward. You fought until the reward came. I need about 10 fighters to jump up right now to say, I'm going to fight until the change comes. I'm going to wrestle until the change comes. I'm going to wrestle until my flesh change. I'm going to wrestle until my attitude change. I'm going to wrestle until I'm being positioned in the right place so I can get to the holy place, the glorious place, the favorable place. So Paul tells Timothy in closing, I've been poured out like a drink offering, brother. Been through it. Been broken. Been spewed out, been poured out. Life has been exhausted. He says, I've been poured out. And I'm a little tired. But he says, but I fought. I fought the good fight of faith. I fought hard. I fought to keep my faith And I fought to see my faith become my reality. I fought the good fight of faith, he says. I finished the course, or I finished the race. I have kept the faith. And in verse 8 he says, finally. Finally. Fine. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're going to get to a place where you can say, finally. Like, I've been sweating and struggling and toiling. Now watch this. I'm going to give you two meanings to this finally. The context of this is Paul is saying, I'm going to heaven. Finally, I'm done with this. But there are certain levels in this life where God will grace you to get to a place where you can say, I fought that battle for 3 years and it's finally done. That specific battle is over. Finally. Just like God told Moses to tell Israel, the enemies you see today, you will not see anymore. Now, if you notice in that text, he's not saying all Egyptians will be completely wiped out. He's saying those specific Egyptians will be done away with. What is he saying? This specific battle, that you've been fighting over these last few years, God said, you're going to get to a finally place where you can say, finally, I got my house. Finally, I got my job. Finally, my marriage is on the right track. Finally, I got me somebody to say I do too. Finally, I'm taking off in ministry. Finally, I'm seeing somebody say, finally, my body is feeling all right. Finally, finally, he says, finally, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me, and not only me, but those who love his appearing. So if there's anybody in this church that want to get to a place where you just want to say, finally, I got some rest. I've been fighting over this thing, and wrestling with that thing, and battling concerning this thing. And instead of me sitting here fighting and people, I'm going to just get on my knees and war in the spirit. I'm going to grab hold to the horns of the altar. I'm going to grab hold to Jesus, the author and the finisher of my faith. Because if I hold on to Christ, if I grab Jesus, if I hold on to him, whatever enemy's been trying to fight us has no place. That's why the Bible says resist the enemy and he will flee. But the way you do that is, he says what? God says clear. Submit yourself unto God. That's grabbing hold to Jesus. And the devil will run. So I need somebody that want to run up to this altar and grab the horns of it and grab hold to Jesus and say, come now, come now, come now. You want to be saved? You want to be born again? You want to recommit, rededicate your life? You're tired of the same old fight? You're tired of going in circles? Rush this altar right now. You want to get to a place where you can open your mouth and say, Lord, in this specific season concerning this specific matter, I can say, finally, now I can wear a crown in this situation. You know what? The beautiful part of that crown, the purpose of a crown, two reasons. It's defined as a wreath, something that you use, something that you wear concerning your victory in the race. But then you also got the crown as far as a king or queen, which means you have been given the victory to reign on top of something. So when he says, finally, I'm coming to get my crown, that means that I'm in a position where I'm reigning and there's no more struggling in this thing. So what is God telling you? Everyone that's running to this altar right now, God said, I'm going to give you the power and the authority to be able to reign over whatever's been trying to reign over you. And you're going to put it under feet, and you're going to put it under the flight. And God said, you're going to be able to stand without being moved anymore concerning that situation in this hour. So everyone that's coming to the altar, close your eyes, open your hearts, lift your hands, open your mouth and say this out of your belly. Say, Lord Jesus, I surrender to your will. Come into my heart. Save my soul. Change my life. Fill my heart with your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, take control. Holy Spirit, empower me to reign on top of every situation. I have the victory over every spirit, every demon, and every situation that's come up against me. I have the dominion. Therefore, in Jesus' name, I stand. I stand. And I will fight until I finish. So, Father God, I stretch my hands over my brothers and sisters who got a fighter in them, who's going to fight the good fight, who's going to stand and keep trying. They're going to fight until we get to heaven. They're going to fight until they see your blessing, your favor, your salvation in the midst of every one of their situations. They're going to fight until it's done. So, Father God, I thank you that the fighters always have victory, for you always cause us to triumph over every situation and in the midst of it all. So thank you for the victory in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Give God a clap offering. Give God a praise in this atmosphere. If you're at the altar and you need intercession, you need a pastor, you need a minister, you need a leader to pray for you, stay at the altar. If you're in the audience and you need a minister or pastor to pray for you, take the middle aisle before you leave the church. At this time, we're going to transition. Please be mindful. We do have new members, baptism, and volunteers class at 1:30 immediately following this service. We're going to pray the prayer of dismissal. Deacons, ministers, let's go forward. Let's get ready. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Let's pray out at this time. We're going to get ready to pray. Father, as we leave, transition this place, but not your presence. Keep us, lead and guide us in all truth. Have your way. Bless my brother and sister, and we thank you for it now. We have a fighter in us, and we're going to fight until the end. In Jesus Christ's name, amen and amen. Hug each other on the way out. The altar's in session. Ministers, let's pray for those that you see. Let's go. God bless you.
Lord, I love you.
Oh.